Good morning, everyone. A happy and blessed Easter Resurrection Sunday to you. Oh, wow. It is such an honor and a privilege to get to be with you here today and celebrating this monumental day, celebrating the victory of Jesus. God's plan of redemption has prevailed. Aren't we thankful? It is so wonderful to see you. Good morning, Janelle. Good morning, Jessica. Oh, hugs to you all. Thank you so much for joining me here this morning as I was praying and just asking the Holy Spirit, you know, what did he want to share today? He led me to Luke 24 and I read it and it was powerful and I'm excited to share it with you. And I'm like, Lord, there's got to be something else. And he led me to a few other passages of scripture. So I'm just excited and so grateful and humbled to share with you all, you know, these different scriptures that God has put on my heart. And I just pray that they are a wonderful blessing to you. And I just want to welcome you all. Good morning, Heather and Prossy and Susan. So wonderful to have you all. God bless you. What a special day. And also, before we jump into the scriptures, I wanted to read a little poem to you. So about 4 years ago, I had the privilege of teaching high school Bible for a half a year, and it was a wonderful experience. And so during Easter, during that school year, the Lord gave me this poem, and I thought that it would be appropriate to read today. And so this is what it says. Barring sin and bridging your gap to heaven, my arms stretched across the tree, wooden beams that my word spoke into being, and thorns that stuck into my head, all for you my love poured out until the world saw me dead. To hell I went to regain the keys that centuries had been in captivity by the enemy. Sin now conquered, out of love I did not falter, all for you. The third day dawning, the grave no longer longing, the debt had been paid. Your path now paved to heaven by him who saved you. To Jesus, what can we say but thank you? And so today indeed is such a wonderful day for us to just praise and exalt our Savior. Amen? So I am just so grateful to get to share this with you today. And if the Lord is putting anything particular on your heart this morning, please feel free to share in the comments below or how you and your family are celebrating this Easter day. Please feel free to share. So we're just going to kind of take kind of a trail through memory lane, if you will, throughout the scriptures and just talking about God's overarching plan of redemption and how his plan has prevailed and how today is one of those climax moments that we get to commemorate of how Jesus was resurrected. So the Holy Spirit reminded me back in 1 Peter 1, verses 19 and 20, how it says that Christ was crucified before the foundations of the world. And that's just a powerful thought to consider. You know, that before God created anything, you know, Jesus knew what creation would cost him. Jesus knew that once God created the heavens and the earth and you and me, that eventually, you know, we would sin. We would, you know, mess up our relationship with God the Father, that we would need a redeemer. And Jesus is like, yes, I am willing. I will be foreordained before the foundations of the world. I will pay the price. I will redeem my creation back to the Father. Isn't that amazing? And so it all started there before the foundation of the world. And then in Colossians 1, 15 and 16, we see that all things were created through Jesus and for Jesus. And because of Jesus, they all consist. He literally maintains and sustains the whole universe. Isn't that amazing? And so I just love, you know, just this powerful, you know, thought that, you know, he was willing to die for us. He sustains it all. Then in Isaiah 53, we read, you know, that he would be bruised for our transgressions, that he would be crushed, you know, that he would pay for our sin. And that was foretold over 700 years before Jesus ever came to earth. So we see God's plan, you know, coming into place. And then in John 1, 14, we see the Word, which is Jesus. The Word became flesh and it dwelt among us, and how Jesus lived perfectly. He had no sin. He was full of grace and truth. He healed the sick. He caused the blind to see. He did miracles. He fed the 5,000. You know, he turned the 5 loaves and 2 fish into multiple, you know, to feed the multitudes. Isn't that amazing? So we see Jesus now on earth, And he even prayed in his last hours of his life. He prayed for the believers. He prayed for you. He prayed for me. Isn't that amazing how we see from before the earth, the creation, the prophecies, and now Jesus on the earth, and then how he was brutally crucified, you know, and we celebrated that on a Good Friday, and even how heaven and earth groaned about that. There was an earthquake when Jesus died. The sun, and the moon, they were darkened. So there was darkness over the earth. The earth literally groaned, you know, for the crucifixion of our Savior. But then today, you know, on Easter Resurrection Sunday, he arose and he appeared. And I wanted to share a passage with you about how he personally appeared. I think that is so powerful that, you know, those several first times that he revealed himself to his the disciples, the believers there, right after the resurrection, he didn't get on a big stage and say, "Here I am." You know, no, he did it very personally and intimately. And I think that is just so profound. And so one of my favorite examples of that is in Luke 24. And so Luke 24, starting in verse 13, and this is commonly known as the road to Emmaus. So maybe you're familiar with that story. And if you have any thoughts about it, please feel free to share below. And it says this: "Now that same day," which was the resurrection Sunday, "that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, 'What are you discussing together as you walk along?' They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Clopas, asked him, 'Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem, and do you not know the things that have happened there in these days?' 'What things?' Jesus asked. 'About Jesus of Nazareth,' they replied. 'He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see. He said to them," this is Jesus, "'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, he explained to them what was said in the scriptures concerning himself.'" Let's just stop there for a second. My dad and I have talked about this before, and it's just so amazing. Can you put yourself there? Can you imagine yourself being one of those two men walking along the road? It's Easter, you know, Resurrection Sunday. It's the third day. This Messiah was said to be risen from the grave, but they didn't see him. And now this man, this stranger, comes and walks and talks with them. And he's talking about, you know, what was talked about in the Torah, you know, in the law, in those first five books of the Bible. And then the prophets, like Isaiah, you know, like we just been talking about, Isaiah 53. And Jesus, not knowing that it's Jesus, walks them through, you know, probably every mention, every time that Jesus shows up there in those scriptures, in those prophecies, those foretellings of who he would be. Can you imagine that? Oh, that would be just incredible. So that's what they're experiencing. And it says, "As they approached the village, Emmaus, to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them." Can you imagine Jesus going into your house? Oh my goodness, that is so cool. Aren't you glad that they urged him to stay? What if they would have just like, "Well, goodbye"? Oh, what they would have missed out on. So get this. It says this: "When he was at the table with them, he took bread." Does that sound familiar? "Gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? And I just think it's so cool how he said that he opened the scripture, you know, the actual word of God, Jesus in the flesh. He was there talking about himself. And so no wonder they felt like their hearts were burning. And so, you know, as we get into the word of God, and even today, just asking Jesus, open up the scriptures to me. Help me to see you and experience you and your resurrection life and power like never before. Amen. And I love too how Jesus, one of his names is the bread of life. We see that in John 6:35, that Jesus was there with them at the dinner table and he broke the bread. So the bread of life was with them there breaking the bread. The word of God was with them opening the scriptures. Whew, what a time that would have been. Wow. And so then it says in verse 33, they got up from dinner and returned at once to Jerusalem. Remember, that was 7 miles. Whew, that's a little bit of a journey. There they found the 11 disciples and those with them assembled together and saying, it is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon Peter. Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Is that not beautiful? Oh, wow. What a powerful passage of scripture. Amen. So we see that Jesus appeared, he comforted, and he restored the hearts of the disciples and the believers. And he did it, you know, in very personal ways. You know, he did it to Mary Magdalene. He did it to these two disciples on the road to Emmaus, you know, to Peter. And I just think it's so beautiful to see how he knew each of their needs. He knew, you know, where their faith was, where their doubts were, and he responded to that as only he could. And then I love how in Matthew 28:19-20, how he commissioned them. You know, he had been with them for a certain time, you know, after the resurrection. Now it was time for him to go back up to heaven to be with God the Father. And this is what he says. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And I think that's a very noteworthy verse for us today too, that Jesus told his disciples that there would have seen him go back up into the heaven. Okay, now it's your turn. It's your turn to go and to make disciples, to tell that you have seen me, that you have heard from me, and that you have my truth within you. Now it's time to share the gospel, that good news with the whole world. And so we too can take note of that. You know, we believe that Jesus is resurrected, that he is alive. We serve a living Savior, not a dead Savior. And he has all authority. He has the power of life. He has conquered sin and death and the grave. This is the good news that we have to share with the whole world. And I love that he says that I am with you. And so he is with you. He is with me. You know, no matter what the times or situations we might face, we have to remember he is with us. So I love that. And so after he ascended into heaven, as we see in Hebrews 12:1-2, that now he sits at the right hand of the throne of God. And then in John 14:3, he says that, you know, he's gone to prepare a place for us. And if he goes to prepare a place for us, he will come back to get us. And so we need to be ready. Every day we need to be spending time with Jesus, getting to know him more, praising him and awaiting his return, right? And then in Romans 8:2, he's conquered sin and death on our behalf. Romans 6:8-18, you know that we're no longer slaves to sin, but we're slaves to righteousness. We have the salvation of Jesus. Then Romans 8:14-17, that now we are children of God through receiving Jesus as our Savior, that we can come to God. Remember that temple veil that used to be in, you know, in the tabernacle is torn. So that means we have that access, that intimacy. intimate access to God the Father. And then John 3:16, and also in John 11:25, that again, that whosoever believes in Jesus shall not perish, but have eternal life. Jesus is the resurrection. He is the life. That is what we celebrate today, that we have that hope. And so we want to share that hope with our friends, with our family, with those around us, that Jesus came to seek and to save those who were lost. Amazing grace. You know, how sweet the sound. You know, I was lost, but now I'm found. And so we want others to taste and see the goodness of God in that, right? So praise the Lord. So let's go ahead and pray. And as we pray, you know, let's just praise Jesus for all that he has done. And perhaps, you know, you're walking strong with the Lord. Praise God for that. That's awesome. You know, maybe your faith has had a little bit of a foggy season. You know, today is a day that it can be resurrected, that it can be revived, that it can be refreshed. Just as Jesus appeared to the disciples that had doubts, you know, that were really disturbed after the crucifixion, you know, he attended to them very personally. So I know that he can attend to you as well. Or maybe you don't know Jesus yet. Well, today is the day of salvation. What better day to place your hope in Jesus and have the hope and assurance of eternal life with him than today, right? So let's go ahead and pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, oh, we worship you. We praise you, God, that we see your plan of redemption has been fulfilled, that your plan, it was carried out through Jesus. And we just praise you for how we've seen your hand at work as we look throughout the Bible and see all the way from Genesis and through the New Testament, how you knew, Jesus, that you needed to come to redeem us, to restore our relationship with God the Father, and that you were willing to do that. We praise you for that. We praise you that you made us, that you created us with a purpose, with a plan, that you designed for us to know you and God the Father intimately, and that through you, Jesus, we get to do that. We praise you, Jesus, that you endured the cross, you endured suffering and sin for our sake, and that because of you, that we don't have to taste that death. We don't have to go through that. Lord, we thank you that you have redeemed us. We thank you for your great mercy and your great love. And Jesus, we thank you that you did come to seek and to save the lost. And so if there's anyone here today that doesn't know you yet as their Lord and Savior, then we just want to pray with them that they would say something like this in their hearts, that they would come to you, Jesus, and they might say, Dear Heavenly Father, I see now that you are God and that you have sent Jesus as the atoning sacrifice for my sin. I confess my sin to you and I repent that I need a Savior, that I want a relationship with my Creator, with God the Father. And as I repent of my sin, I place my faith in Jesus. I believe in my heart, Jesus, that God raised you from the dead, that you took my sin, that you took my shame, that you took all my baggage on the cross, and that because of your resurrection, I no longer have to bear that. That you, as far as the east is from the west, you have removed my sin from me. And I confess now with my mouth, Jesus, that you are Lord and you are my Lord, that I want you in my life. I want to know you more and more. And as I get to know you more, I want to share your love. Help me to understand you and your ways. And I thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming and for filling me and helping me to know you more. And so, God, we just thank you and we praise you, Lord, for anyone who just joined us, Lord, anyone who just joined the kingdom of heaven through that prayer. We just worship you, God. We praise you. Thank you, Jesus, for getting glory all over the world today. Thank you for drawing hearts. Thank you, Jesus. We just speak your name and your resurrection power all over the earth, all over the world, for every heart, Lord, every nation, every tribe, every tongue, that every knee would bow, every tongue would confess that Jesus, you are Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Thank you for helping us to get to know you greater today and to really ponder and appreciate the power of the resurrection. We worship you, God, and we just thank you that you are King of Kings. You are Lord of Lords. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth in our lives as it is in heaven. We love you, Jesus, and we thank you for the resurrection, and thank you that one day we will get to be with you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you all so much. God bless you. Have an amazing Resurrection Sunday, and I can't wait to be with you again tomorrow. Bye-bye.